A very good afternoon to Dr. Mukesh Patel, sir, and all the participants. On behalf of SNPITNRC Umrakh, managed by Vidya Bharati Trust, I welcome you all on the second day of the workshop on mathematical modeling and their applications in sciences and engineering, sponsored by GUJCOAST, DST, and Government of Gujarat, and organized by SNPITNRC Umrakh. We once again welcome our eminent speaker, Dr. Mukesh Patel, sir. Dr. Mukesh Patel, sir, is very dynamic and we experienced his power in the previous session. In this session, sir will describe mathematical modeling on partial differential equations. So I now hand over the control to Dr. Mukesh Patel, sir. Please, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. Am I audible, everyone? Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay, so how can I present, because Zinal Nayak is presenting.
Yes, sir. Okay, now, sir, you can present.
Okay. Okay, is the screen visible?
Yes, sir, yes.
Okay. So, good afternoon all. And once again, thank you very much, Dr. Mansi, for inviting me and giving a chance to interact with you people. As we know that in a previous 2 days session, we have already seen some of the mathematical models by Dr. Jayesh Dholia sir and Kausal sir, in which the detailed explanation was given on mathematical modeling, how the mathematical modeling can be done, different situation, how the different situation can be tackled using mathematical model, and how we can solve the real time problem with the use of mathematical model. And yes, we have already discussed about the mathematical modeling on ordinary differential equation by Dr. Kausal Patel sir. Today's our session is on mathematical modeling on partial differential equation, that means PDE. So I think all of you are aware about partial differentiation, but before we go on partial differential equation, let me take a brief introduction of ODE and PDE, then we will move towards the partial differential equation. So as we know that the ordinary differentiation, the derivatives, the variable y is depend upon variable x, which means that the changing, any kind of changing in the variable y due to the changing in variable x is denoted by dy by dx. This dy by dx shows the variation of the value of y at particular point x. This variation may be positive or may be negative. If you observe, if you observe that the here at point xa, your dy by dx at this point, if you see the tangent at that particular point dy by dx, which is positive slope, so it indicates that the derivative is positive, the variation is positive, while at the point xb the variation in y is negative because the tangent at that particular point, which is negative slope, which has negative slope, such that is a negative. So the equations which consist the derivative term, ordinary derivative terms, which is called as ordinary differential equation, maybe it is a first order, second order, or higher order, it's depend upon the particular terms, so which has already been discussed by Kausal Patel sir. So we just quickly move towards the partial differential equation. So now the partial derivatives, obviously partial derivative is one of the important aspect in the field of variations. While one variable is dependent upon more than one variables, so dependent variables are more than one, while independent variable is only one. Now in a Jayesh sir session, in a morning session, I think you have already learned about multiple linear programming problem, similar concept over there, when one variable is depend upon more than one variable, which means that changing in many variables impact on the changing of the particular independent variable. Changing in a very independent variables is changing in the impact on the changing into dependent variables. So here the independent variables are x and z, which is a, and dependent variable is y. So you can say that it is a two-dimensional kind of thing. You can also say it's a three-dimensional because one variable is depend upon two. You can also have more than one variable, x, z, w, v, so that you have a changing in a y accordingly. In a real-time situation, sir might have explained that he definitely one variable, it is very rare case when one variable is completely depend on only one variable. In a real-time situation, you know that one variable is depend upon, definitely depend upon more than one variable. And changing in more than one variables is impact on the particular variable. Let me take an example. Like let me take an example of agriculture, because we belong to the agricultural area where crop, the production of any goods or crop is depend upon fertilizer, land fertility, water availability, and so many treatments are there. So one variable is depend upon more than one variables, and changing in one of them impact on the production of the particular crop. Similarly, you know, if you observe in your home, cooking is one of the best example. When you make a recipe, the taste of a recipe, the quality of the recipe of any food is depend upon more than many variables. Your heat, your, you know, ingredients you have used, the material you have used, so many things are responsible for the taste and the quality of particular food. So real life, whenever you go about the real life, definitely you will get the dependency, more and more dependencies. In such case, either you have to follow multiple dependency problems, like one of the best I like most is nothing but multiple regression analysis in statistics, which solve the problem of this multiple dependency. Multilinear programming also there, partial derivative is also there. Okay, so these are the concepts of partial differentiation, where one is depend upon other. But partial differentiation is a limitation. The limitation is what? At a time, if two variables are varying, yeah, your dependent variable cannot give the answer. So you have to fix one variable at certain point, and then you have to vary other variables. And with respect to that variable, you can derive the value of the dependent variable. Like, suppose you want to take y as a dependent variable on a variable x and z. Okay, and suppose at, if you fix any value xk, and suppose you value, if you vary the value z, you vary the value of y according to zk, then you can say that it is a del y by, sorry, in this case x is fixed and you are varying the value of z, derivative you get is a del y by del z. Here in place of d we are using del, so del shows that it is a partial derivative. That means when, if any other constant or value are considered as a constant term at that particular point, and only variation in z with respect to the variation in y with respect to the variation in z. If you see that, you can say that the x is fixed at this point, x point is fixed and z is varying. The black dotted line says that z is varying. According to that, the, you can see the variation of this particular graph. Okay. So it is a del y by del z. Similarly, if you fix a value zk and you vary the value of x and horizontally, yes, it is called as del y of del x, where z, any term which is in the form of z variable, which is always considered as a z variable. You know the value of z, and at a different value of x, you are varying the value of y. That is called a partial derivative of y with respect to x. Not only that, you can also take x, z, you can change the multiple plane also as the dependency of y on a different variable. So this is the term of partial differentiation that you have already learned about this particular differentiation. But what is partial differential equation? Those equations which consist the partial derivative terms, whether it is a first order, second order, or higher order, which is known as a partial differential equation. And if we see the general form of partial differential equation, the general form of partial differential equation is del square y by del x square plus b del square y by del x and del z plus c into del square y by del plus into del y by del x plus e into the where a, b, c, d, e, g all are constants. Now, if you take constant b, a, and c, which is nothing but the coefficients of the higher order, yani second order partial derivative terms. If you find b square minus 4ac, that is that you know that square minus 4ac equal to 0, then this PDE is known as a parabolic PDE. If b square minus 4ac value is greater than 0, then PDEs are known as a hyperbolic PDE. And b square minus 4ac is less than 0, you can see the particular nature of the partial differential equation, the general nature, specific partial differential equation like Laplace equations, Poisson equation, one dimensional heat equation, two dimensional heat equation, three dimensional heat equation, similarly n dimensional heat equations and wave equations, one dimensional, two dimensional and many more. These are the standard partial differential equation. Yeah, according to the situation and according to the model and according to the real conditions, you can add, you can delete or you can edit the term into particular equations. Okay, so it's depend upon case to case, right? So there are so many partial differential equation out of which I'm just focusing on one or two partial differential equation in this session, which is most favorable and mostly used in a very much frequently it is used in a different cases to solve a real time problem, and which is nothing but your heat equation. Okay, so it is a very basic concept of heat flow, partial differential equation, how it will be derived. I'm not going very much detail into mathematical terms because it's quite that kind of thing that which is consider which consists details about the proof of mathematical term. So I'm just trying to explain what is heat equation, what is heat flow, what is the nature of the heat flow in one dimensional, in two dimensional, and I try to show you the physical representation much in case of the theoretical representation of this heat flow, such that you will get a better idea of heat flow. Okay, so suppose we let me start with the one dimensional only, then we move towards the two dimensional heat equation. So one dimensional heat equation says that suppose I'm taking a rod which is considered as a one dimension. Again, before we go inside this particular session and particular solution or the explanation of partial differential equation, let me assume something, because here there is a lot of variation in heat equations, but we are here considering just a normal situation with a controlled environment. So we are not expanding or we are not modifying our original heat equation. We are just stick to the original heat equation, and we will discuss how it is generated and how it is helpful. So just ignore the exceptional case of particular heat equations. So let me start with this one dimensional heat equation in the rod. Suppose you put this rod in x axis, having location x0, 1, 4, 10. So actually this is a continuous domain, but we are just considering a point over here. Okay, so this is called a space. Now at time t is equal to 0, that means at initial stage, at initial time, suppose the heat is distributed across the rod is like this, which shows that at the initial portion, at the initial portion of this particular rod, it is the heat is highly distributed and slowly and gradually increasing towards the end of the rod at time t is equal to 0. Now over a period of time, suppose there are two different cases, either we leave it this rod as it is, or yeah, any question? Hello,
yes, no, sir.
Hello.
Audible, sir.
Okay, I think something, so I just stopped. Okay, so at t is equal to 0, that means at initial time, suppose the heat is distributed in this thing like this, which is represented by this graph. Okay, now
different cases. No further heat is given to particular road, or that means the road providing, we are continuously providing the heat. So suppose in both the cases, we will see with the examples also, but suppose over a period of time, as time pass slowly and gradually, as the nature of this particular heat transformation says that the heat is always transformed from higher to lower, that means higher value of heat is transferred towards the heat having lower value. So yeah, and T of x, T is nothing but temperature at point x. This point indicates the temperature of particular road at particular point or location, better you, we will use the word location, at location x. And over a period of time, I'm not changing road, I'm changing the graph only. This is the graph at time t is equal to t1. Now the changing in time, the interval of time may be differ. You will take 1 minute, you will take 2 minutes, you will take one hour, 2 hour, whatever, depend upon situation. But in general, we will say that it is time t is equal to t1. At time t is equal to t1, the heat flow will be distributed across the road. Similarly, at time t2, slowly and gradually, and at t is equal to t1, you can see that the heat is distributed uniformly. At certain level, we know that the temperature of it depend upon the material of the particular road and diffusivity of particular road. It is depend upon the property, which kind of material you have used, copper, metal, copper, silver, or iron, or any kind of aluminium, or what kind of road material you have used, and what is the its thermal conductivity is there. So I'm not going inside it at this stage. Okay, so it's very technical. Okay, but in general or in a control environment, we can say that the heat is flowing from one end to another end slowly and gradually, and at certain levels it's become a very, the heat is distributed uniformly. So this kind of nature is happen in the particular situation in the role. This is known as a one-dimensional heat equation, and which is generally denoted by del t by del x, where t is a function of x and t, because x variable as well as time, x and time, x and space, your location, you can say that, and t is a time. So delta t, which is shows that the in temperature with respect to, there is a mistake, delta t by delta small del t by del, just a second, sorry, it is a printing mistake. It was a printing mistake. It's a delta T by small del T. That means what? The temp variation in temperature with respect to time, which is depend, is proportional to the variation of time temperature with respect to space or location x in the second order derivative. Where C square, you can say that C, it is generally denoted by C square. So it is says a thermal conductivity. You can use C, C square, whatever value, some in some books you can find alpha, sometimes some book is you will find beta, but ultimately this C or C square value, which is known as a thermal diffusivity, and which can be obtained by K into rho, where K is denoted by thermal conductivity of the material of the road, whether it is copper, silver, iron, or aluminium, or whatever, and rho is indicated as a density of the material of the particular road. So this is the just a constant, you can use any symbol over here. In some book it is a C square, some book is a C, some book it's alpha, beta, whatever it is, but it's a thermal diffusivity coefficient. Okay, so now the question is, what is the nature of this particular one dimensional heat equation and how it is generated. So I'm not going into the, I'm not going inside the proof, the mathematical proof of it, but I'm just going, I'm going to just show you how it can be generated with the help of this physical interpretation. Now, there is a two type of domain, you know very well. One is a continuous domain and second is a discrete domain. Can anybody tell me what is the difference between continuous and discrete domain? It is a very basic thing that you know very well. Continuous and discrete. Continuous part and discrete part. What is the basic difference between them? According to which the domain is defined.
So continuous means it is given interval wise, or in some interval it can take a particular point. Or discrete, that means we are just given it point wise, we have to adopt that point only.
Exactly. Exactly. Okay. And if we want to take a real time example, suppose you are roaming on Chowpatty at seashore, right? And suppose you are walking on the Chowpatty, so you have a footprint on your you have a footprint on sand. Okay, clearly it is visible because it's a Chowpatty, right? So can you tell me there is a path you are having a path of footprint on the Chowpatty? This path is discrete or continuous?
The path is, sir, continuous. We can consider just a single footprint as a discrete one, single point. We may have a footprint at any of the points.
You have talked. Yeah. Suppose you are talking about one interval. Suppose some origin to some destination, you have walked on a particular sand. So you have a path from this particular beginning point to this ending point, and you have a path. Your footprint on this particular sand. This complete path in this particular interval is called as a discrete or continuous.
Sorry, sir, can you repeat a question?
Suppose the question is, you have decided two point, one point from which you have started to walk, yes, and second point you have ended your walk, right? So this is one interval,
yes,
distance you have covered. Now when you walk on that particular interval, you have a footprint on sand,
yes,
right? So it is in a path from one end to another end. Is the path said to be continuous path or discrete path?
Path is continuous, sir.
Path is continuous. Okay. Actually,
just interpreting only one interval. Only.
Okay. Now it is said to be discrete.
If we have more than the one interval, then it may be discrete. Just an interval.
Okay. Within that interval, okay. Within that interval, it is a discrete path because you are not considering all the points on the particular interval. From starting to end, yeah, means suppose your step size is 1 feet or 2 feet, 1 feet or 2 feet, then there is one point at starting, second point you are having at the 2 feet, third point at the 4 feet, then second point is on a 6 feet. So this is a point to point you are walking, right? You are not covering the whole particular sand surface of this particular interval. So this is called a discrete part. Now suppose you want to make it continuous part, what you will do? अगर आपको उसको कंटिन्यू क्या करोगे? हम छोटे थे तो हम लोग करते थे. हाउ यू विल कवर योर होल इंटरवल?
बाय कवरिंग ऑल द पॉइंट्स. दैट मींस वी कैन नॉट लीव एनी.
हाउ यू विल कवर पॉइंट? हाउ यू कैन नॉट लीव एनी ऑफ द पॉइंट? व्हाट काइंड ऑफ वॉक यू विल प्रिफर टू मेक इट कंटिन्यूस?
Minimum step size.
Okay. If the distance between two points is making it very small, it tends to zero. Suppose it tends to zero, then what kind of nature the walk has? Mathematical term I'm asking. If tends to zero, the difference delta x tends to zero. Definition may be at a limit and continuity. Till h tends to zero, right? Okay, then if you take the different distance of your footprint, make to tends to zero, then what kind of nature of the path? Wo kis tarah ka nature ban jayega path ka?
Path is Then it will be discrete.
Now, what you have to do, without stepping up your feet, you just drag your foot from one end to another end. You will get a complete, you know, drag karte ho, pair ko uthate nahi ho bilkul. You just drag your path, your leg.
Then it will cover all the points and it will be continuous.
Yeah, definitely. So when you do not step up your foot, you just drag your leg or foot from one end to another end, there is a path, whether it is a curve form or linear form, which is depend upon your movement and vibration of the particular leg, but it is become a continuous path. So within that interval, you are not leaving a single point between, you know, between these two particular between these two point or interval. This is called a continuous path. So here you can see that if I go back, the blue line is a continuous domain. It's a continuous path, there is no break. But here, if I take this part in a discrete analog, that means I'm taking the point, I'm taking the location x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, x7, x8, x9, x10. I don't know what will happen on x4 or x5, what will be the temperature between the two points x4 and x5. I don't know. I'm taking the points only x1. That means I know that I noted a point. I have taken a thermometer and just I am not dragging the thermometer across the road, but I'm just putting the thermometer on particular point, say x1 point. I have just put this particular thermometer and I have checked what is the temperature. This is called t1. At the second point, I'm not dragging, I'm taking just like a foot. I'm just putting a thermometer and the second point x2, and I'm just measuring what will be the temperature, what is the temperature at the point x2. That is called T2, similarly at X3, similarly up to X10. So I'm not dragging and I'm not taking all the point across the road such that it is a continuous. Okay, so you know, this is the discrete domain I have taken. Okay, let me take a discrete path or discrete analog of this particular heat transformation. I'm selecting some of the locations X1, X2, X3, X4, X5 up to X10. Yeah, difference between x1 and x2, what is the interval size or length of interval you are taking, which is depend upon you. If you want to make it very closely and very tense to zero, it's become continuous. But I'm taking very nearer points, say x1, x2, x3, x4, x5 up to x10, at a discrete analog of this heat transformation or heat flow in a particular road. And t1, t2, t3 indicates a temperature at that particular point. Okay, so t1 is a temperature at x1, t2 is a temperature at x2, and t3 is a temperature of x3. Okay, now what will happen? Yeah, the temperature of T2, what will happen after a period of time, as time goes on, what will happen at point T2? Let me fix a point P2, yani at location X2. What kind of changes will happen in the temperature at location X2, which is depend upon its neighbor. One neighbor is X1, second neighbor is X3. That means what is the temperature at X1, T1 and T3? It's depend upon it. If we take the average of T1 and T3 divided by 2, that means is the average temperature of particular point, T1 plus T3 by 2. And if I take the difference between the average value of the neighborhood values, the temperature at neighborhood values, and at the point where we are going to derive the what happened in the temperature at particular point X2. So if I take a difference T1 plus average minus T2, if it is greater than zero, that means here you can see that here, if it is a greater than zero, a neighbor temperature is greater than zero, that means that obviously the T2 will be increased, because hume pata hai ki temperature is always moving from higher value to lower value. So T2 is a lower value, so it absorbs the temperature from the higher side. Okay, so T2 will be increased. And suppose your T1 plus T2, suppose in T1 plus T2 by 2, yani the average value of neighborhood value temperature is less than minus T2 is less than zero. Agar usse T2 se low hota, that means T2 is higher value, then the T2 will release the heat towards its neighborhood value. So if it is less than zero, so temperature will be decreased at T2, decrease at point T2, at point X2. So T2 will be decreased. In our case, if we observe a graph, if I take the average of T1 and T2, at this blue line says that it is the average value of neighborhood points in temperature is higher than T2. Yeah, it is higher than T2, such that in our case T2 will be increased. So this is the basic fundamental of this particular heat flow. Okay, now some of the calculation steps we have to understand. So deviation I'm taking at particular point only, then we will convert this discrete analog into continuous analog. So if I take the derivative term, derivative of T2 at time T, deviation of temperature T2 in time T, which is known as alpha into that is proportional to, you can say it's proportional to, and alpha is any constant, is proportional to T average minus this difference T2. Okay, this is a first order derivative. Now if I set this first order derivative into second order derivative term, differentiation of differentiation, you can take in this way, this is called T term by taking LCM is 2T2 is set as minus T2 here, and this plus T1 is taken in this way. So here I, while delta T2 is known as a difference between T2 and is a constant. So it is a difference T2 minus T2, T3 minus T2 and T2 minus T1 both had a differentiation term, and it is nothing but I am taking the difference of difference, because here delta T2 and delta T1, and here you can see that there is a minus sign over here, that means delta T2 minus delta T1, which shows that the difference of difference, which is known as delta, it can be indicated as delta T1. So it's a second order or second derivative term, delta T1. Okay. Third concept from here, if delta T2 minus delta T1 is greater than zero, agar T2 is increased and delta T2 minus delta T1 is less than zero, then T2 point will be decreased. Okay. So d T2 by dt is known as alpha by 2 delta T1, which is the second differentiation. So how the second differentiation is come into the picture because of this reason. Okay. Now let me begin with here. One point. But if I convert this discrete analog in IX, or you can say the interval length, and it's become tends to zero, then I'm considering all the points. I'm not leaving any single point on the particular graph. If I take all the points, then obviously it is called as a continuous domain. So if we talk about a continuous analog, that means it consists all the points, then it can be written as delta t upon del capital t upon del small t is equal to c square del square t upon del x square. Now why it is del square t upon del x square? Okay, how it comes over here, because if you observe that at this particular point your del t by del x is negative, fine. If you move towards the another points and slowly and gradually, once you come over here, you can observe that it is changed. The slope of this particular del t by del x is different. Here the slope is different, which means that in the temperature, but the variation is again vary at location wise it is vary. That means the variation in temperature is again variation. So it's a variation of variation location wise. That is why it is called as del square t by del x square. See, you can see that delta t by delta x is vary. Yani it is variation in delta t by delta x. It is also a variation. Each and every location, the variation is not remain same. At a different location, the variation is also vary. Okay. So it is called as variation in variation, such that del square t by del x square is involved in this picture, and such that here you have an equation delta t by del t, del t by del capital T by del small t is equal to c square into del square t by del x square. So that here the slope of delta t by del x square is greater than zero if slope is increasing. If slope agar increase ho raha hai, then it is a positive. If the slope is decreasing way, then the second order derivative term is negative. So this is the how, this is the, you know, a basic fundamentals of one dimensional heat equation, how it is generated. So del t by del t is equal to c square into del square t by del x square, which is known as a one dimensional heat equations. Okay, similarly two dimensional, that means in place of road, suppose you are taking a plate, a metal plate, so it has a x and y both direction, such that the variation in a particular point xy coordinate, suppose I'm taking this point, So what will be the temperature of this point over a period of time? As time pass, how the temperature is increased or decreased at that particular point, which is known as del T by del T, which is known as C square del square T by del X square plus del square T by del Y square. So only one term is added in a second derivative, which is del square T by del Y square, and where T is a function of X, Y, and T. Okay. Similarly, dimensional, if you take dimensional, definitely X, Y, and Z, three planes are involved in it. Okay. And delta T by del T by del T is equal to C square into this particular. You know that the three dimensional, suppose in this particular winter season, you have observed that, okay, in your staff room especially, okay, at some wall there is a sunlight over there, at some wall there is no any sunlight. Suppose you have a room that is three dimensional and only one side wall having sunlight, right? So obviously the photons of physics, I'm not belongs to physics, but this is a general concept, or I'm not belongs to, you know, electronics or electrical field. I'm from mathematics side, but the general concept I'm discussing, sorry if I do any kind of mistake, okay, please correct me. So if there is, you know, only one side, at one side of wall you have a sunlight, so the heat is coming from that wall, the photons are coming from this particular wall and heating up this air inside this particular room. So it is in three dimension, upward, forward, and x, y, z, three directions, the heat will be slowly and gradually, the environment of this particular room becomes warmer. So how much time it will becomes warmer? Agar aapne pankha on kiya hai and you suppose, sorry, in initial stage you just come to your office and you have put on one a beautiful and one heavy jacket. So, and right now the temperature is this much, and suppose you want to measure, okay, slowly and gradually the heat will be increasing, in how much time at particular location the temperature will be increased and I have to remove my jacket. So, you know, you can derive, there are so many factors. I'm again telling you, there are so many factors are involved in this particular heat flow. But if you take just a normal situation by ignoring other factors, or by not ignoring, by taking them as a constant, and just you just fix your particular heat flow on three dimensional variable x, y, and z, and if you find it, you can approximately derive key within a 1 hour or within a 2 hours the temperature will be going up, and after 1 or 2 hours I have to remove my jacket, I have to start the fan also. Okay, so you know, these are the small thing that we have to observe. So obviously mathematical modeling is much depend upon observation, not much depend upon calculation. Calculation is the second part, but observation is the first part. Okay, so you just think about it, okay, how it can be done. Now every PDE can be, but most of the PDE can be solved by analytical method or numerical method, exact method, analytical method, and the numerical method. Okay, so here we are going to talk about the numerical method. That I believe that Jayesh sir and Kausar sir has told that if you follow the exact method, you will get a better solution. Definitely you will get a better solution, but the problem and limitation of the exact solution is whenever you have a situation, and suppose you convert that situation in a mathematical model form, and suppose this form supports the existing methodology, whether it is analytical exact solution method, if supports that particular method, then it can be applicable only. So this is, yeah, and once it is supported by this mathematical model, then sone pe suhaga, it will give you a better answer. But most of the time, if you take a normal situation, then it's okay. But when you go for the research work, you add more and more parameters. Not only add, you add, edit, and delete more parameters such that your mathematical model is changed. In such case, your existing methods, exact or analytical method, does not support that particular modification, and you are unable to apply the exact or analytical method. In that situation, somehow the numerical method will deal with it, and you will get the solution using numerical method. Though it is not accurate 100%, but it will satisfy your requirement as well. Okay. And as I believe that when you go for experiment, generally, whether you're from engineering field, any engineering field, medical field, management field, or science field, when you go for experiment, you always get a readings and numerical quantities most of the time. So once you get a numerical quantities, three types of models are more very much applicable. One is a statistical model, which deals with the numerical data. Second is a numerical method, numerical analysis, which deals with the data. And third one is the operation research. On morning session, Jay sir has already explained, it also deals with the numerical data. So three models, I believe that three models should be taught to the student such that when they go for experiment, they can deal with that particular quantity data. Okay. So with this consideration, I'm just focusing on the numerical solution of this particular one-dimensional heat equation. Okay. So how it can be solved? So this is a one-dimensional heat equation. Then we move towards this two-dimensional. So one-dimensional heat equation I have taken. And suppose the distance between two point is delta x is equal to h. Here I'm considering that each and every point, I'm taking the location, some of the road, and they are equidistant. That is my assumption. Okay, you can also change. If you change the distance, every interval you are going to change, your formula will be changed accordingly. Okay, so I'm just fixing this particular, at this moment, delta x is equal to h is fixed for all the locations, and the region x0 to x10 at t is greater than 0, subject. Okay, when you go for numerical solution, you should have, it has a limitation, and it requires some of the things, some of the conditions that it requires, and on the basis of that conditions, you can derive the solution. The conditions are said to be initial condition and boundary condition. If the problem has initial condition, then it is called initial value problem. If the problem has a boundary conditions, then it's a boundary value condition. So initial conditions and boundary conditions are required, and if you observe these equations, del t by del t, which is nothing but a partial derivative, that means one initial conditions is required for in time domain for the temperature, and while the temperature del square t by del x square is a second, which means that at least two boundary conditions, initial and boundary initial or both condition, that means called boundary conditions, is required for the temperature with respect to x. So here initial condition x0, so I'm just explaining in detail because baad mein main explain nahi karunga, first hai, that is why I'm just taking it. T of x comma 0, what meaning of T of x comma 0? Temperature, you know that T is a function of x and t. Here you are saying that t is equal to 0, that means at time t is equal to 0, that means time t is equal to 0 means initial time. Initial time means what? When you have started the analyze, or when you have started your experiment, that is your initial time. So at t is equal to 0, all the values of x, that means is a phi of x, which means that initially when you start your experiment to measure the temperature of road at different locations, when you start your experiment at initial, very initial stage, that how the temperature is distributed across this particular road. This is your initial situation, because as you know that physics and engineering people know very well, because electrons are always moving over there, which means that there is some initial temperature. Even it is in a room temperature, if you have put your road in a room temperature, there is some temperature already exists in the particular road. So initial temperature, it is denoted as phi of x. Now keep in mind the conditions here, I have taken phi of x, the phi of, or maybe it is a variable. That means there's some equation, cause some curve, it follows some function also of x. Now boundary condition x10t, that means the first location, what is the temperature? At last location, what is the temperature? Whether the temperature remains constant over a period of time, or whether it can be changed. If the temperature remains constant at that both the locations, start and end location, it is remain constant, you maintain the constant temperature at that particular point, then the conditions are taken as a constant, A and B are constant. But some cases, suppose you are taking that, no, at initial, yani the starting point, at end point, the temperature is also changing over a period of time, then you have to set in a function. How it is changed in a function, how it is changed over a period of time, and which function it will be, it follows which function, then definitely in numerical analysis, you have one of the chapter is curve fitting. You have to collect some of the data, past data. Okay, over a period of time, you have to take the observations, x0 location, you take the observation with respect to time, and you have to fit your curve. whether the curve is a polynomial, whether the curve is exponential, logarithmic, trigonometric, or transcendental function you will get. So with the use of, so initial and boundary condition, you cannot take just randomly. For example, we are assuming any sample data, but when you go for the real time experiment, you if you know the nature of particular 2 points, variation of temperature at 2 point, then you can take it. Otherwise, if you do not know, then you have to take the observation at 2 point, and you have to fit a appropriate curve that follows this particular point, and you have to fix the initial fix both the boundary condition in a form of function. So these are some of the things which you have to keep in mind. Delta t is nothing but the time difference, the time interval you are taking. You are taking a reading per minute. After 1 minute you are taking, after 10 seconds you are taking, it depend upon you. Okay, it depend upon experiment. So this is the basic initial and boundary conditions. So it is very, very, very much important how it can be considered. So here in this particular session, I have taken it as a randomly, because it's a sample only, demonstration only. But if you go with a experiment, real time experiment in your research work, you have to collect the data, you have to fit the curve. If it is remain constant, there you have set, you have one, suppose you have some instrument over there which make it constant temperature, then you just write down this is temperature 2 degrees Celsius at both the end, or 0 degrees Celsius both the end. So throughout the time period you will consider it both are 0 0 0, because we have controlled that particular 2 point. But if it is not controlled and it is a free from this particular heat transfer flow, and it is changing over a period of time, then how changes follow which function, that you have to derive a function. Are you getting my point? Constant and variable form of conditions.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So it is very difficult, na? When you go for research work, you have to keep in mind. You do not take. I mean, आपने ले लिया कि चलो ये ले लो. What people is generally doing, and what they do is a mistake. What they are doing, they find a solution. What actually many researchers are doing, they have a heat equation or any ordinary or ODE or PD equations, they find a solution, and in the solution they put T is equal to 0 and what the equation you are getting. At T is equal to 10, what the value you are getting, x is equal to 0, what the value you are getting, x is equal to 10, what your values you are getting, and this is considered as an initial condition. But it is not always true. It is, if you are solving just an example for examination, then it is okay. But for a real time experiment, if you go with a research work, it is not work really. So you just take curve fitting in place of that assumption. You just take, follow the curve fitting, you fit appropriate curve in this particular interval, time interval, and you follow that in particular for curve or function by curve fitting, it will give you better solution. Okay, chalo. So numerical solution having different approaches. One is a finite difference method, second is a cubic spline method, third most popular finite element method, and so many other methods are there. But most commonly method which is used as a finite difference method. Nowadays we are working on a cubic spline method as well. One of my student has completed his PhD on using cubic spline method, one dimensional heat equation. Now second is doing on a two dimensional heat equation, where we are using cubic spline approach, B-spline approach. These are a different approach through which you can find a solution of the heat equations. Okay, now if you follow the finite difference method, so finite difference method is basically work on the difference between 2 points, the temperature difference between 2 points. If I take delta T by delta T, here you can see that left hand side, del T by del T, which is nothing but if I take, see, I for X, J for T, I for space, J for T. So if I take the time difference, J plus 1 minus J, keep in mind Ti, J plus 1, Tij, that means the difference between J plus 1 minus J, actually the temperature difference in time T, divided by K, because it's an interval, you can write T. This is called a forward difference, because A and J plus 1, you are taking the difference from the J plus 1 minus J, then it is called a forward difference. Now del square T by del X square, I'm using the central difference formula. The standard formula, we know that in a numerical analysis, T, and here you can see that the temperature to space X, that means the variation in I minus 1, I plus 1, where J is remains as it is, which means that it is a difference in time t, temperature t, with respect to space x upon h square, right? So this is t I minus 1 minus 2 time tij plus ti plus 1, second order differentiation in space x. Tij is indicated as t of xi and tj. Okay, if we put all these differentiation values, finite difference value, in the given equations, you are getting something like this. And finally, if you change the variable and if you just sort out it, you will get k, yeah, this equation. And if you assume k c square upon h square, where k is a time interval, h is a space interval, and c square is nothing but thermal diffusivity coefficient, so r is nothing but a constant value, which is denoted by k c square upon h square is a constant value which is denoted by r. And if you put this value, I will get the final solution tij plus 1. Here tij plus 1, that means at I location j plus 1 time, because j time, yani t is equal to 0 time, initial time, you know that. That is why at j plus 1, we will start with the j plus 1, and t1 time we will start is equal to r ti plus 1 j, ti minus 1 j plus 1 minus 2 r into j. So this is the solution given by this particular finite difference method, and this method is given by Smith. Okay, so if we see this diagrammatically, if we observe it, then we can see that, yeah, so this is the initial, the point is tij. Then here it is, this is x location, x to x up to xm. This is a time interval, t0, t1, t2 up to tn. Okay, and if I take I, tij over here, so this is called I minus 1j and I plus 1j. If I take over here, this is ij plus 1, here I minus 1j plus 1, I plus j1. That I have not written, okay, but it is understandable. So the formula tij plus 1, that means the known value of temperature at time t is equal to 0. This is the value at location x0, and this is the known value at location x10 or xm. Okay, so we have to find just value of temperature in between the range of this particular locations x. Suppose I want to derive the temperature at this particular location. So here you can see that this is a time t line, time x time line, time t2 line, time tn line. So I'm talking about t0 line, I know that. I want to just derive minute. Okay, yeah, after 1 minute. Okay, so if I want to derive tij plus 1, if you see the formula, tij plus required this term. So tij plus 1, first required ti plus 1j. That means this value should be known. Yani previously, the right side location value in a previous time, 1 minute ago, the right side neighbor value should be known. Similarly, ti minus 1j, that means 1 minute ago, what will be, what was the temperature at the left side neighborhood point? And tij, that means that what will be the temperature, what was the temperature at the same location in a previous time, yani 1 minute ago. If these three values are known, obviously it will be known because initial condition are known, you can derive this value. Similarly, if you find the value of this, you need this three location, this one, this one, and this one, right? But you cannot derive this location because there is no such location available on the right hand side, such that the initial or boundary condition says that this must be known. So this is known such that when you go to find this value, you have a right value exist. Okay, so these values are known, so you just derive this particular location value at temperature. So if you see that this formula include jth level and j plus 1, so you can see that known as two level formula. Not only that, if you want to derive j plus 1 level value, the are required only at j plus 1 level value are not required. You have to know about the temperature of this location in a 1 minute ago, okay, 1 minute before, you have to know this value. That means that it is a explicit scheme. If at this level value, if the current time value is also required, then it is called an implicit scheme. So here the previous time value is only needed, and two levels are involved in this particular calculation, such that it is called two level explicit method, and this method is given by Smith. Okay, let me take an example. Del t by del t is a heat equation. Let me take, I'm just taking this value randomly, initial and boundary conditions are taken as a demonstration, but when you go for experiment, again you have to derive it by your own self. So let we take C squared, the diffusivity, the diffusion of this particular heat in this particular road is 0.05. Interval I am taking in H location is 0.1 only. Interval in time is taken is 0.1 second or minute, whatever you can take, and the length of a road varying from 0 to 1 meter or whatever you can take, and time I am taking 0 to t, 0 to 1 as a second, minute, hours, whatever you can take. Okay, subject to the condition, initially the heat is distributed as sine pi x. So I have already draw the graph of sine pi x with the value. Okay, so sine pi x graph, that means you can see that in the end of the road temperature is again low. So within an interval from 0 to 1, this is when from 0 to 1, the initial distribution, when you start your experiment at and you observe the temperature in the road, the temperature is distributed something like that before experiment or before you are doing any kind of research in the on this particular road. So initially the temperature distributed in this way. This is a given thing that you have to derive. If you have an experiment, you have to derive this one. Okay, but here I am taking T of 0T, that means what, at x0 location, at x is equal to 0, it remains 0. That means for all time T, it always remains. That means some mechanism I have used, some, you know, I have controlled the environment. First location, whatever time spending in an experiment, it is always remains 0. And similarly, x is equal t of 1t, matlab x is equal to 1, and any time t, it is also 0. Matlab to end, I have maintained the temperature constant. That is why I have taken constant condition. If it is varying, then I have to set function. Okay, so and t is greater than 0. Okay, so here at every time t is equal to 0, 1, so 0.0, 0.1, 0.2, and 1.0, t remains 0, and here also t remains 0. So this is called a bounce. This formula, and if I derive this value, see, this is the table. Equal to 0, initial values are given. At time t is equal to 1 and 0.1, you are getting these values. And slowly and gradually, values are going to be decreased over a period of time. When I started the analysis, whatever temperature it is, distributed in a road, I'm leave it as it is. So slowly and gradually the temperature will be reduced and it will be uniformly distributed over the particular road locations. If we see the graph, you can see that, yeah, the red line indicate that is that t is equal to 0. Initially the temperature is very high. At middle the temperature is going to be decreased. At t is equal to 1.0, the temperature is reached to this, matlab the reduced to this particular locations. Now if you go ahead under 1 minute, again suppose I go 10 minutes, 15 minutes, at slowly and gradually if you go ahead and ahead and time pass, it also becomes a nearby zero. It will become flat over a period of time. If we see this particular thing, so here at t is equal to 0, the heat is something like that. Slowly and gradually it is going to be reduced, and over a period of time it is reduced to the 0. So here it is up, we are going upward only if t is equal to 1. If you go t is equal to 2 up to, if you go to 2, t is equal to 3, 4, 5, if you observe that, you can observe that this become nullified, or the road becomes at the room temperature, whatever it is. Okay, so here in this case both the end is 0, so it is nearby 0, and we cannot say it is exactly 0, but we will reach to the nearby 0 only. Okay, so this is the one dimensional heat equation. The in that case we have lived it the road as it is. But suppose in this case, suppose I am heating up, constantly heating with the same amount of heat I am giving to particular road, what will happen? So again I am taking the second case where C square is equal to 0.6, H is equal to 0.25, K is equal to 0.05, and the length is varying from 0 to 2.5, and the time interval I'm taking from 0 to 0.5, and initially t of x0, see the function x square minus 3x plus 3. Last time I have observed, we have observed here this is I have derived this equation curve fitting. If I take this value at particular location, what kind of curve is fit? The curve is x square minus 3x plus 3. That means that initial temperature distribution follow this equation. I'm just fixing the temperature at T is equal to 0, x is equal to 0 at any time it is at 3, and 1T is 1.75 at T is greater than 0. At the initial points, it is higher temperature, middle and up to the end, it is a lower temperature, and somewhat it is temperature you are getting at the end locations, but with initial time. After experiment started, these two points remain constant, and the constant is here. I am taking not zero, let we take it is a 3. So I am taking the heat, and heat is transforming from one location to other location, where initially whatever temperature we are taking, it remains constant at throughout the time period. This is the thing I have controlled in this particular road. Okay. So if we see the table, and if we follow this Smith method, you are getting this particular table. Okay, at end location 1.75 like that, and suppose if you give heat over here, the heat will be transferred gradually. The remaining locations 0.25 to 2.25 will be increased, and as usual, the temperature is diffused in that particular location over a period of time, and slowly and gradually it becomes higher. And if you go on and on, 0.5, then T is equal to 1, T is equal to 2, this becomes more flatter. So this is the scenario of one dimensional heat equation. Now another method was given by Crank Nicholson. It is very much important because it's an implicit scheme. That is why I have taken into consideration. So here, if you observe that, again, if I take del T by del T, C square del T by del X square, del T by del T is nothing but, I am taking forward difference in time, fine. Here I am taking central difference in time, But suppose if I replace this central difference by its j plus 1 and j and j plus 1 time row, agar main usse usko replace karun, then what will happen? So this will become something like this is the average value. It's a jth level and j plus 1th level central difference formula. And I'm taking this plus this divided by 2, 2 name and a bahar le liya, so c square by 2. And you are getting the average of this. If I simplify it, I will get these equations, where r is equal to k c square upon h square. So if you closely observe, if value, location temperature value, how many values you require? First, previous time value, ti minus 1j, tij, ti plus 1j. These three values which we have already used in a Smith method. But also, tij plus 1 require the left value and right value. If you see, again, I'm telling you, different method has a different approach, and whatever situation in your problem exists, you have to follow that method. Otherwise, every method is giving the better solution. If you observe carefully, this is time t. If I put t initially, and this is again the same road, but even timing, which means that to find the temperature at this location, I require, what was the temperature of this location in a previous time? Also, what was the temperature on left neighborhood on previous time? What was the temperature of right neighborhood on previous time? Right? As well as, because heat is moving from left to right. So, and this point is in between. And so, at these locations also, temperature will be there. Some temperature will be increased over there. So, at this current time, what is the actual temperature of this particular neighborhood at current time, and right neighborhood in current time? It will also impact, it will also affect the temperature of the current location. So I'm taking the surrounding temperature, you can say that. Time temperature of neighborhood are also taken into consideration to find the temperature of location at current time. So implicit scheme also giving a better idea, because considers value also. But the thing is, it's a two level such that, but it's also you required a current time value. This value, this value, and this value. This value is supposed to find left and right value both should be required. Such that it is called an implicit method. So this is called two level implicit method. Now the problem is here that if you want to find Tij plus one in a previous method, this previous three minus one ij and I plus one j is known. But here the left and you know very well. But right value, which are going to be find in which are going to be find in the next step. This is not known. This is unknown value. Similarly, if you go ahead, this is not a boundary. Suppose it is not boundary, and suppose in between value you are taking, you need left value and right value, which is left value is probably obtained according to the iterations. This value is obtained, then you go to the right side, but the next coming value is unknown. So here you cannot use this kind of equations and simply you can derive. And yes, if you have not a mode of the system of equations, so these methods follow the system of equation, right? Just a second, huh? And we know that, yeah, this is the okay, this is a system of equation. How to solve system of equation? So here you have a question, AT is equal to B, like this. If you follow the methodology, you will get a coefficient matrix something like this, the variable matrix is something like this, and B, the constant matrix, you are getting this. And if you solve simply inverse method, T is equal to inverse B, you will get all the values of this particular location at a time. Okay, and if you see the graph, the similar nature, you are at initial stage you are getting this, and gradually the graph is going to be down. So these are the two methods I have described. Other methods are also applicable: iteration method, Dufour-Frankel method, successive or relaxation method are the method through which you can derive the solution of this particular one dimensional heat equation. Okay, now two dimensional heat equation, you are just in place of road. Suppose you are taking a plate having x and y direction, and over a period of time the temperature increasing at different locations of this particular plate. Suppose you are taking here ij n, where I for x, j for y, and n for time t, right? So these points are known as ij on n, here ij my ij ij n ij n ij n minus 1 I minus 1 j I plus j difference here, second order differentiation in x, central difference formula in x, second order. This is the specific case. If you are taking h and k both are different, your model will be changed. Okay, so here we assume that k, the location we are taking, the grids we are deriving on a particular plate which are equidistant. If you take the h and k different, then your model will be changed. But if we suppose take this one, then we are getting this formula, okay, where r is equal to lc square upon h square. This is called alternate explicit method. Okay, so the formula says dimensional zero, all the values are known. Have decided some of the location, you just measure what will be the what was the temperature of this particular location, you just measure it. So initial value knows that, so the plate initial temperature on this particular plate is known, all the values are known. Suppose that after a time, 1 minute, suppose you want to derive according to this formula n plus 1, that means at the time interval you want to derive the value of this particular location temperature, then how many values you require? You need the previous value, you need first of all the same value, same temperature value at the same location in a previous time, then top, left, bottom, and right value in a previous time, okay, not current time. So here there are, this is nth level in time, this is n plus 1th level in time, but in n plus the value of this temperature at this location, you do not temperature of location at that particular, such that the previous time value is only required, so that it can say that it's a two level involved, so two level and explicit method. Okay, right. So ADE method says that, and we have taken example cases, x is equal to 1 by L is equal to 2. These are the parameters. Why we have taken the parameter case? Because I'm giving you stability. I'm not going inside, but you have to remember this thing. The R is the coefficient LC square upon H square, value R. So R is very much important because this coefficient value, the stability is one of the criteria. Okay, when if you follow this method and how much it will be stable, matlab over a period of time, aap kitna bhi aage badho, the stable will not be destroyed. The system will not be destroyed. It will give you the solution. So if you want to take the solution of that by this method, you have to maintain the value of R. This value must be close interval 0 to 0.5. Agar aap uske andar maintain karoge, that means your system will work from long time. That is why I have taken such kind of values, such that your value R belongs to the instability. Yeah? One of the huge field, NIT and IITs are having this subject stability, in which this particular topic has been covered. Okay, so T of x, y, 0, I'm taking the initial condition. See, difficult. 2x condition. This rho equal to 0, you get that all the boundary size, the temperature is low, but late, the temperature is increased. So this is 2xy. And again, txy, t 0, t is greater on all the boundary. That means the two boundary condition for x, two boundary condition for y, total four conditions there. One of two boundaries of x, this one, and this one, and two boundaries of y, left and right, top and bottom. So it says that we have fixed that at boundary point of the plate, the temperature is 0. Yeah. Again here, if you are varying the temperature, you have to derive the function. Okay. Fine. Now I'm not going inside the calculation. I'm just giving you the output of this software. We have already coded this code in our software, because which is in our syllabus. So this is the output from the Octave software, which is an open source of MATLAB, in which we have coded the one-dimensional and two-dimensional heat equation code with all this method. And the output says that if the T is equal to 0, all the values of temperature at different location is over here. T is equal to 1 by 72, the time of this particular plate locations we have derived. Okay, if we see the another graph, something like this, you can clearly visualize that initially there is some this pass. You see that the top side, the temperature is going down, and it is distributed over towards the boundary. So if you see the graph, and though both the thing, the picture as well as graph, so slowly and gradually it is over the plate, and it is, you know, slowly and gradually it's become a it is going to be reduced over a period of time or boundary. So this is a two-dimensional heat equations. The problem is there, you can take different conditions, you can take a different situations according to which you will get the answer. Not only that, these functions or this equation can be modified as well. Let me take an example. Burger equation, if you heard it, Burger equation, which considered it is an expansion of the heat equations, which consists two parameters on the right hand side. One is a diffusion coefficient parameter with a second order derivative of x, and the advection, diffusion and advection, both situation is handled by the Burger equation. Okay, so it is modified version of the heat equations. This is the method we have discuss. Another method is Duffer-Frankel and Crank-Nicolson method, implicit method, through which we can solve the two-dimensional heat equation. Okay. So this is the examples of heat equations in a temperature different distribution. But how these heat equations, one-dimensional or two-dimensional, can be implemented in another field? Yeah, most important thing. Suppose you want to take heat equation to solve any other domain you have selected, and suppose you want to apply the heat equation, you have to consider some of the things. One is the parameters and the situations, the nature of heat equation. If you have to follow, if your situation is following the nature of heat equation, then you have to fix your, you can convert your situation into that particular heat equation form. If it is directly fit to the particular equation, then it is well. But suppose you need some modification, you have to modify it. Once you modify, your model will be changed, the solution will be changed. Okay, keep in mind. So here we have just tried to solve this population growth or derived population growth using heat equation. So it's a population growth model. OD is also following a population growth model. So here PD is also having a population growth model with some assumptions are there, and which is very in a controlled environment. Okay, otherwise population growth is depend upon so many things like your birth rate, death rate, your immigration, emigration. So many things are involved, and slowly and gradually it will becomes, it is developed. But I am not taking all these cases, I am taking a simple case in this at this time. So the case says that in a recently developed linear colony, matlab the assumption that the colony is a linear, you have one kind of a street of a city, the residential population is distributed as shown in figure, some this. Over a period of time, the listening means settle down in the colon, settle down rate of 0.01. Here this rate is very much important because it is depend upon the carrying capacity, the location, the quality of the location, the standard of living of this particular location is depend upon so many factors. Out of these factors, by calculating these factors, we can assume that okay, this coefficient is something like that, 0.01. You can calculate just like a thermal conductivity is calculated, depend upon the material you have used for the road or plate, and you calculate all these things. Similarly, for a population settle down rate or movement rate or displacement rate, you have to use parameters related to population. But here we assume that it is a settlement rate is 0.01. And keep in mind, if you take the population in percentage rate or whatever, population is always, the percentage always count on not 100, it is always counted on the base of 1000. If you take one percentage matlab, not 100, 1% out of 100, no, it is a 1% for 1000. Okay, something like that. So find the population distribution over the colony in a given world by considering initial and boundary conditions, so given as follows. So P for population and with respect to time is the variation of pop space or location x. Here c square we are taken as 0.02. here you have 0.02 also. here rate is 0.02. Yeah, there is a printing mistake. Here, 0.0 h is equal to 0.1 kilometer, the interval in location. K is equal to 25 years, the time interval you have taken, 0 to 1. X is varying from, t is varying from 0 to 4. And at initial location, if the population is fixed, matlab there is a saturation point of this point, location where 130 is the maximum capacity and it is fixed at initially. And throughout the time, it remains as it is, but the newly entered population will move forward. They cannot locate on that particular location. Okay, T1T, that means at the last location, the population is zero. Okay, so yeah, this is the colony. We can just imagine at location 130, it remains constant throughout the time interval. And if you see that slowly and gradually it is decreasing. Initially, distribution of this particular population over a colony, across a colony, is nothing but something like this. So this is just like a heat equation. The temperature is distributed. Now, Smith method, Crank-Nicolson method, or whatever, Dufour-Frankel method, successive or relaxation method, so many numerical methods are available. One of the methods, suppose you have adopted, suppose a Smith method, you have explicit scheme, or Crank-Nicolson method, you have adopted. And suppose you derive the graph or solution, so see that at t is equal to 0.0, there is a initially the population is distributed something like that, and after the t is equal to 4, this is the distribution. So 130 remains constant, here 0 remains constant, but here you can see that 100 become 109.11, 80 become 89.75, 60 become 67.6. So the location, there is an increment in the population density over a location over a period of time. with the by following the simple Hurt equation. So this is one of the population growth model. One of my student has completed his PhD. He's about to complete his PhD using the one-dimensional Hurt equation on a population growth model. There are so many cases we have taken. Okay, so we will discuss later on in it. And now one of the students is doing the same thing with the use of two-dimensional Hurt equation. Okay, let me take another example, lake pollution model. Okay, so it's a okay follow the compartment model also, but if we restrict some of the situation in a pollution of lake water, then we can also follow the heat to the equation. So in the industrial area, the wastage of chemical is released by at the initial study, the population created on the surface of the water. Because agar main usko depth mein bhi le jaunga, to isko 2D ki jagah 3D mujhe use karna padega. So I am taking that the pollution is just spreading on the surface of the water only. By wastage is given below figure. If the diffusion rate of the chemical in water is 0.02, then find the pollution density at the given time by considering the following initial boundary conditions. So here I am del P by del T is equal to C square del square P by del X square. Here I have set some parameter. Okay, this is point K is equal to 0.1 month. You can take 0.1 meter, L is equal to 0. You know, you can take any variable. So yes, 0, comma X, comma Y is lesser equal to 0.5, right? Matlab X and Y direction is varying from 0 to 0.5. Time is varying from 0 to 1.5. So the boundary condition in Y says that at X is equal to 0, all value of Y is 2 and here. And 0.5 Y T is again, it is a 0. T and 0.5 T is equal to 1. This value is coming from initial. This is for t is greater than 0. This is at t is equal to 0. Okay, when you start your experiment and you have observed that at which the pollution is like this, after that over a period of okay. So at t is equal to 0, if I find the solution here, yeah, this is the initially, it is this time goes on. If you follow the two-dimensional Hurt equation and follow any method, you will get slowly and gradually it is going to be increased. The another locations are increased by the pollution. So how much time the whole lake will be polluted, and what will be the density of this pollution on the particular lake, you can derive with the use of this two-dimensional Hurt equation. So this is the some of the applications of one-dimensional and two-dimensional equations. Okay, thank you very much. So this is some of the application I tried to cover. There are so many applications are there. You can follow the wave equation, one-dimensional wave equation, two-dimensional wave equation. So there are so many applications. Not only as fixed equations you can use, there are so many modifications also over there. But it's depend upon totally your situation. What kind of situation you are facing? What kind of parameters are involving in this situation? According to that, you have to modify your heat equations, one-dimensional or two-dimensional or any wave equations or other equations. Okay. Any query, any doubt, you can ask me. Thank you.
Dear participants, do you have any query regarding this session? If you have, please help. You may ask to the sir. To sir.
Yeah, please, any query you can ask me.
Actually, sir, many of us find this partial differential equation very tough, actually.
But actually it's very common use in engineering, especially mechanical and all these branches, because most of the problems are dealing with these heat equations.
Yeah, exactly, sir.
And in real time, definitely it follows. If you go with the research work, you have to follow this, because recently some of the application in a medical field, especially tumor growth, some of the applications in a porous medium for oil recovery, some of the applications in a and a different population growth model that I have discussed. So many applications which follow the heat equations, definitely you can use it.
Yes.
So if you go with research work, you have to use higher model.
Yes, sir. Actually, I have one
question. Any question?
Population growth model is also feasible for ordinary differentiation. And now just you showed us that for partial differentiation. So which condition we may just disinguish that which model is we have to follow which model? That means which?
Yeah. So if you take the ordinary differential equations, you know that
which type of constraint we may consider for making a partial derivative.
Okay. So see.
Sorry, sir.
You can see it's okay. Ordinary differential equation, when you follow the OD, you know that the variation in population is only with respect to dy by dx, dp by dx you have taken in a previous lecture, I don't know.
Yes.
So it is depend upon the variation in population with respect to time or with respect to x only, right?
Yes.
In ordinary differential equation. But once you follow the partial differential equation, you can vary in a both way. Okay, over the location wise, what will be the increment of population, or you can find in a time domain or time variation, how can we find the population? So both the way you can derive the population. Both the way you can derive the population. Now, as I have discussed partial differentiation, if you fix the location, if you fix a particular location, and at that particular location, suppose you're Gujarat is a one state, suppose, and you are not interested to find the population in the across the Gujarat. Suppose you are want to find a population in a Surat city only. So you just fix the Surat city, okay?
Yes.
Yeah, do the Surat, the population increment in population in Surat city is affected by the surrounding region. But you do not want any kind of population growth in the surrounding region. You need only the population growth in the Surat city only. At that time, you can fix with the partial differential equation. Okay, this is the fixed region, location x is fixed, and over a period of time, the partial derivative with respect to time t, you want to derive the population growth, so you can derive with the use of this heat equations. Well, in OD, it is difficult.
Thank you very much, sir. Actually, I got a very clear idea.
Okay.
With your explanation, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Is there anyone who wants to asking someone something to sir?
One more thing I want to tell you, those students or those participants want to do PhD or research work in this particular area, population growth model. So one of the technique, finite difference method, is very initial method, which we have already applied and which we have already solved it. Okay, so many of the people from NIT and IIT, you can observe, if you see the research paper, to numerical analysis, where cubic spline method, solution of ODE by cubic spline method. Hota hai aisa kuch?
Sorry, sir, actually your voice was
I don't know. Because GTO ki syllabus hai na. Okay. What I'm saying?
In the previous syllabus, yes, sir.
Okay. Because finite difference method is very useful method, but more accurate result given by the spline approach. If you go with the spline approach, linear spline, quadratic spline, and cubic spline, it is very, very interesting method, and very, it will give you a better answer. So nowadays the research work is going on cubic spline method approach. So one of the student, one of the student has completed with this cubic spline approach, and second student says the cubic spline approach in a two-dimensional heat equations with the population growth. So these are the method. Not only that, if you go with the finite element method, this is cubic spline method, I'm just taking time 2 or 5 minutes. If you're taking finite difference method or cubic spline method, both are working on discrete domain. That means on a plate or on a region, at particular location, xy coordinate yani location, jaise maine bola footprint, that is a discrete domain. So discrete domain ki value data hai, but suppose at every location, suppose you want to find the value of particular temperature on a particular plate, you have to take h or k, yani the space difference between x or k, you have to take very minor. But in place of taking this discrete domain, suppose you want to work on a continuous domain, matlab you have to consider all the point of plate or road, better you follow finite element method, which work on continuous domain. Yeah, there is some integration formula over there, there are some weighted residual method over there, Galerkin method, Rayleigh method, so many methods are there which will work on it. But these are the future scope of the research in which you can do your PhD as well, if you really interested in PDE. Okay, that's all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Good afternoon all. It was really a wonderful and informative session that I found. Now let me give you highlight of this session. Sir started with basics of partial differentiation and he moved to partial differential equation. That was quite effective. He also explained classification of second order partial differential equations. Then he discussed conductivity of heat flow equation of one dimensional in perspective of both discrete and continuous analog. Dr. Patel gave overview about two dimensional and three dimensional heat equations also. He also prominently showed solution of one dimensional as well as two dimensional partial differential equation using different numerical techniques. He also told us about some of the softwares using that we can get our solution or required solution. So it was quite informative, sir. Population growth, he discussed also about population growth model and lake pollution model. It was also informative and interesting indeed. We would like to see you, sir, again for more this type of expert talk.
My pleasure.
Now, thank you very much, sir. Now, moving ahead to valedictory session, I request head in charge of Applied and Mathematics, Applied Science and Humanities Department from SNPIT and RC and coordinator of this online workshop, Dr. Mansi Zaveri, to share few words for vote of thanks. I hand over the session to Dr. Mansi Zaveri. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Jinal Nayak. It is my privilege to propose a vote of thanks and acknowledge the contribution of those who worked hard to make this workshop successful. First, I would like to thank our eminent speakers, Dr. Mukesh Patel sir, Dr. Kaushal Patel sir, Dr. Jayesh Zoria sir, that they joined us and gave their valuable time for us. And thank you, Gujcost and Department of Science and Technology, Government of Gujarat, for the grant of this workshop. The entire SNPIT and RC family, the management, the trustees, administrator, Professor Akshay Gupta sir, Principal Dr. Piyush Jain sir, my colleagues, Professor Khyati Patel, Professor Jinal Nayak, and Professor Tejas Patel, and the entire staff of Applied Science and Humanities Department in helping us in making this workshop successful. I would like to thank all the participants for their enthusiastic participation, and I hope that this workshop would be benefited in your research and to achieve your future goals. All the very best everyone in your future endeavors. Thank you all. all the participants, please fill feedback forms. I will share feedback forms also through the email. It is necessary for the to achieving e certificate. Shortly we will send e certificates through email to each and every successful participants. Thank you so much. If you want to share anything, then you can share with us your experience. Anyone from the participants, you can share your experience with us for this 2 days workshop. Any feedback from your side?
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, it's Ashutosh Mishra, Assistant Professor, RGPU Bhopal.
Yes.
Department of Mechanical Energy. First of all, I would like to congratulate the organizers for organizing such a grand event. We have learned a lot from the course, ma'am. It is a short but very, very informative sessions. And we would like to again join in future also. If you are going to conduct such kind of events, kindly inform us, ma'am. Thank you so much for your kindly cooperation and for organizing this event. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. If there is any query, then you can directly contact to me, sir.
Sure, 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 ma'am. Thank you.
Yes, sir. If there is any query regarding and I request Professor Dr. Mukesh Patel, sir, that kindly please share the PPTs with us so that we can share with the participants who anyone who left in between or due to some internet problems, who have not who attended this workshop or any sessions, then we can share with them.
Okay, sure, sure.
Okay.
Sure, madam.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mukesh sir. We again meet you in some future workshop or STTP, sir. Thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Animesh sir. Thank you all.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you very much, ma'am. All the six sessions are very nice and very interesting, ma'am. We learn a lot, especially in mathematics. There are very few FDP from this time, this COVID time.
Yes.
I attended more than 50 FDP during 6 months, but in mathematics, only 3 FDPs are there. And this FDP is in 2 days, all these six sessions are very, very much informative and give a new idea, which is very much correlated to our undergraduate, which we teach in undergraduation courses. Real application and real research application, how can we apply it?
Yes, sir. That is the most important part, that how and when we can apply this mathematics to, and we can correlate these two different areas.
Continuously students are asking that what is the use in real life or what is the use in the research area. Then all the six session and all the six eminent speaker are very, very much eminent knowledge in their field, ma'am. Thank you very much to giving the opportunity, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Madam Vaishali Bhavsar here.
Yes, ma'am.
Although I'm not from maths background, I'm from physics. Yesterday's two sessions were really very informative for as far as my field is concerned. I'm a person who does practical work. We work practically more. But Jayesh sir's that simulation topic and then Kaushal sir's drug topic was very interesting. Today's session was also very informative, but yesterday's two sessions were very helpful for me, because nowadays first simulations are done, the results are seen, and then we just carry out the same thing in practicals. So we do the experiments then. And that is the reason why I joined. I have completed my PhD and I have also done the experiment. But the junior student who is there under my guide now, she is expected to do the simulation. So I also thought, and today everyone is doing simulation. So first we get an idea that what are the problems that we will face, so that we can overcome and we can, you know, get better result when we do it in experiment. So the session was very helpful, and I'm thankful to you that you allowed me to take part. Although being of physics field, you allowed me to take part in this FDP. Thanks a lot, madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the feedback. Okay, thank you all once again. Thank you, Mukesh sir. All the three speakers are very helpful in nature. So participants, if you feel any query in future, then you can contact them directly through mail or anything. They are very helpful in nature. Thank you, everyone. So I am ended this meeting, and soon I will share the certificates with each and everyone through the email. Thank you, everyone.